Welcome to Concepts of Programming Languages. In this video, I'll talk about concurrent systems, and I'll specifically talk about the programming constructs of forking and spawning processes. I'll say something about critical sections, and I'll end this video with the notion of barriers. So let's get started. Concurrent systems could be seen as a paradigm for programming whenever you have multiple processes. So you can then think of a process as independently of other processes to execute, say, a sequence of commands like we have seen before, causing effects. It is now interesting that these different processes run independently of each other. There are two different ways you could understand running multiple processes. The first is multiprogramming, as it is called, where you run multiple processes, but you schedule them and interleave them, as it is called, on a single processor. So although there are multiple processes, each running independently of each other, they all are making use of one processor to actually execute. A different way is multiprocessing. In multiprocessing, these multiple processes are run also on multiple processors. And so there, in multiprocessing, it is possible that you actually execute two processes at the same time. So what is a process? You can think of a process, or it is also called a thread of control, to have its own control point, so position in the program, as we have seen before whenever we executed programs. Each process has its own call stack, eh? So whenever it calls procedures, these are done all within the context of a single process. And each process maintains the values of its own local variables. So the variables are local to a process. However, in both cases of multiprogramming and multiprocessing, it is possible that... I'll come back to that later. Let me emphasize here that whenever you have multiple processes, that these processes are progressing, so executing independently of each other. And so it is possible for one process to be processed in a higher speed than another. So it could appear as if a process is very slow while another process is executing in a very fast way. And now the reason why we call these concurrent systems is that if you think of these multiple processes, then think of them as all competing with each other to influence the overall program's outcome. And this is why it is called concurrency. Now, there are many different flavors of concurrent systems. And the most important one, at least in this video, is shared memory concurrent systems. And in shared memory, whenever we have multiple processes, each with their own control point, call stack, and local variables, they do share among all of them the main memory. So that means that, for instance, global variables in a program are shared among all processes. And now it is possible that one process modifies this shared memory, and this modification then is visible to all the other processes. And in this way, the processes can exchange information or influence each other. Another flavor of concurrent system is non-uniform memory access systems. So where shared memory, in shared memory systems, every process has access to the same main memory. In non-uniform memory accesses, some processes have, say, access to specific memory that is local to them, or that they can access in a more fast way than other parts of the memory. And the non-uniform memory access is most typically used these days whenever you, for instance, talk about, say, Intel or AMD multi-core computers, because these computers make use of higher keys of memory, each which have a different access and modification delays. This causes a different way of thinking about how processes are competing with each other. So you could also say some processes share memory with other processes, so that sometimes a process shares memory with other processes, but sometimes a process has memory only for itself, so that it is stored locally to local to the process. Another way of thinking of concurrent systems is distributed systems, in which not only you have processes, each of these processes that are competing to influence the program's outcome, these processes furthermore are then distributed in space. So that means that not everything is in part of a single computer, you could say, but you could understand the overall system to consist of all small parts that are maybe linked together in a network. And in that case, you can think of processes to share no memory, and that no memory shares, that no process shares memory with the other processes. It is that every process that runs on a different part on the network is isolated from the processes that run on other parts of a network of processors. And to communicate, you instead have to exchange messages with each other instead of modifying the value of global variables. And there are also many other flavors. So you have cluster computing, in which you build up a cluster of computers that are all pretending, although they're separate machines, they're pretending to be a single machine. And then you have grid computing, where you have a distributed system, but you supervise computation on this distributed system. So they could all the computational processes are cooperating in computing a global outcome. Okay, so in this video, let's focus on shared memory concurrent systems. So we have processes, and all processes share memory with each other. So let's consider an example in this shared memory concurrency, shared memory concurrent system. Let's say we have the following program. On the left, you see the program associated to one process, and on the right, you see the program associated to another process. So let's say we have two processes running. Now we have shared memory that is shown below in the box. So that means that whenever the execution of the program on the left wants to write or read a variable, it has to do this in shared memory. And the same applies for the process on the right. So let's say we execute it. So here's a control point for the process on the left. Say it's about to execute x is 0. And it has executed, then x is 0. So then this process modifies shared memory. And you can think of updating that state, where now x is assigned the value 0. Now, on the process on the left, we are about to execute the assignment command y becomes 2. But before we do that, we actually do that. Okay. So now this executing this command again modifies the shared memory. So we now have the assignment of x to 0 still. And we additionally have the assignment of y to the value 2. Then we can say, okay, we perform x becomes x plus y. So we have to read from the shared memory the value of x and y, which is 0 and 2. And after executing it, 0 plus 2 is 2, so we assign 2 to the value of the variable x. And then we subtract 2 from y, but now something else happens. Because we are dealing with a concurrent system, suppose at this point the other process starts to execute. So we now have two control points. Already three commands have been executed on the left, but now the other process starts to run. So you can understand this control point about to execute x is 3. Now suppose that other process executes x is 3. This does not influence the process on the left. The process on the left you can think of running independently of the process on the right. But the process on the write has made a modification on the shared memory. So when it executed assignment x becomes 3, indeed the value of x is modified and now becomes 3. And let's say then the process on the right executes y becomes 0, okay. And then we can say that x becomes x minus y, so x remains 3. Oh no, no. In this case now the process on the left starts to take a computational step. And so the point I want to demonstrate here, it is that in a concurrent system, you do not know which of the processes will take a step. So this is a particular example that I now show, where these steps are taken. But you could also take these computational steps in a different way, where the processes are running at different speeds than as is shown right now. But now in this case, let's suppose before the process on the right executes the assignment of x, we first consider that the process on the left now performs a step in which it reads the value y, but hey, the value y was changed by the process on the right to be 0. So whenever we now execute the command on the left, the value of y becomes minus 2. So these processes influence each other by modifying the shared memory. So now the process on the right again takes a step. So let's say the process on the right then executes x is x minus y, but y is now minus 2, so x should become 5. There is an error on the slide over here. Y is assigned 2, and so y becomes 0. So then it prints, there is an error on the slide here, it should be 5. It should now print 5. Not as it is shown that it outputs 3. Okay, so that is one particular example. You could also consider another example. So let's start again fresh. So we have a process on the left and a process on the right. They both have a different program that specifies their computation. So let's say that the process on the left then is about to execute x becomes 0. And now the process on the left has performed that step. So the shared memory is updated, but now the process on the right comes. And it is about to execute that x becomes 3. So let's say that the process on the right then takes a step. Now what happens is the process on the right takes another step. So it's now very fast. So it also executes the step y becomes 0. But now the process on the left takes a step again. And it overrides the effect of the process on the right. So the process on the left has assigned y to become 2. And then what happens then? The process on the left then reads x and y from memory, so these are 3 and 2, so then x becomes 5. But now the process on the right executes, takes a computational step, it reads x and y, so it has the value 5 and 2, so it subtracts 2 from 5, and now x becomes 3. Y is increased by 2, by the process on the right, and then y is decreased by 2 by the process on the left, and then the process on the left prints the value of x, and that gives you the output 3. So in the previous example you have seen an output 5, and now in the example here you see an output 3. So depending on the speeds that these process execute on, these speeds depend, they influence the outcome of the program. And this is the main point of concurrency, that these processes are independently running at different speeds, but that they are racing each other and that they try to compete to change the outcome of the program. In this case, this particular racing, where one process and another process try to race to the finish, you see that the outcome results in a 3. In the previous example, the outcome was 5. So then, for the same program, you could ask yourself questions like, is it also possible to get output 0? And now try to think, pause the video if you want to figure it out for yourself, but try to think of in what way, in what order, could you let the process on the left and the process on the right run such that the resulting outcome of the print statement on the left will output you a 0. Well, and is it also possible to get an output 5? Yes, we've seen that. Is it possible to get an output 7? Also that, try to figure out whether you think it is possible or not. And finally, the question, are there any other outputs possible than 0, 5, 7? Yeah, we have seen 3 as well. But are they all, or is that it? And how do you know that there are no other outputs possible? So to answer that question, we have to dive a little bit more into the details of what is going on here. Because what I assumed implicitly here is that either a process on the left takes executes a command, a whole command, or a process on the right executes a whole command. But we assume that these commands are executed as a whole, right? It is also possible in some programming languages that the execution of a command itself consists actually of smaller micro steps. For instance, read a value there, read a value there, then perform some kind of addition operation, then maybe read another value there, perform another addition operation, and then write the value to a variable. And these micro operations themselves can then compete with other processes that execute commands that themselves also consist of micro steps. And so it is not always the case that the command that you write in your program necessarily is what is called atomic. So atomic means indivisible. So that means that either you take it all, you can see the effects as if you would run the command in isolation, and there is no way any other process could interfere with that. But in reality, things are more complicated. Other questions that you could ask. So whenever two or more processes are executed on a single processor, then think of how you would do this. We had seen two processes and these control points were moving at different speeds. But what if you have only one physical processor? How is it then possible that this happens? Well, this interleaving of two processes, first running process on the left, then running process on the right, then running process on the left, etc., etc. You could accomplish that by scheduling processes on processors. And for instance, you could even use different ways of performing this scheduling. You could let a process run on a processor until it itself issues some kind of command that then says to the processor, okay, at this point you can swap me out for a different process. And that is called cooperative scheduling, because the processes cooperate with each other to ensure that all the processes get time, execution time on the processor. Alternatively, you could have a real-time interrupts, so that there is a real-time clock that ticks, and then whenever a particular real-time interval has elapsed, a signal is then given to the processor, which interrupts the execution of the processor, which then causes one process to be swapped for another process, and then in that way you really get that this interleaving of the processes becomes real-time dependent. But all these topics are quite interesting themselves. I mean, it is possible to go really into the depth here, but let's not do that. But let's ask some other questions. Whenever you have that two or more processes are executed on multiple processors, then it is possible to execute commands simultaneously, so at the same time. And these processors should then interact with some kind of shared memory device. But then how would that work? And if you execute two processes on two processors, then these two processes are said to be executed in parallel. But then whenever they perform operations that can influence the other process running on the other processor, what can you then understand whenever you ask yourself the question, what happens if two commands are executed precisely at the same time? And what if they would interfere? What would that then mean? And what I already explained to you a little bit. What if a command was now subdivided into these micro steps? And these micro steps could be, for instance, interfering with other processors, also executing micro steps, maybe working on the same variable that is stored at the same memory location. And so raises a lot of questions that you have to deal with in practice, and it's not simple. Whenever you want to write concurrent programs, you will most likely run into issues of correctness because of all these possible different things that could go on that are not visible whenever you pretend there is only a single process in the universe that executes your program. But the understanding concurrency mathematically and analyzing models of concurrency itself is a very advanced topic. Itself very interesting. You might want to continue with that in your future studies. But also in practice, there are lots of practical considerations. For instance, how does the design of such a multiprocessor system look like? That they have to have independent execution units. If you think of the von Neumann architecture, these multiprocessors, they must have multiple control units, each maintaining their own control point within the, say, a program. They should be connected with shared memory, so they should be connected to the same memory devices. But maybe this is too slow, so then you have caching hierarchies for speeding it up. So also practical considerations here. It's itself also an advanced topic, so let's not dive into it here too much. This is just to show to you that these concepts exist and that you know of that they exist. Okay. So now let's consider a way of programmatically working with processes. And one way to do that is, suppose we start with one process, like we used to do before, that we have a program and it starts executing at the start of the program. How could we then construct or create multiple processes? Well, one way of doing that is forking. So let's suppose we start indeed with this single thread of control. Then forking is a way of expressing in the program that you want to programmatically create a new process. So let's say we have some kind of procedure. It has the following signature. Let's say it's a function, so it has a return value. It does not take any arguments, but it does return a Boolean return value. Now you could say forking is performed whenever you call the procedure fork. The funny thing is, you call fork once, namely from the given process or thread of control you started with, but it actually returns twice. Namely, it returns in one process, say the original process that called the procedure, it returns the value false, but in another new process that it has constructed in the meantime, the procedure at that point will return the value true. So from that point on, your program is executed by two processes, and these two processes only differ in what that single return value was given back. And that single return value can then, of course, influence the future execution as specified by your program, because you could do a conditional test on whether the outcome is true or false and then have different behavior specified. An alternative way of creating programmatically new processes is by spawning processes. And by that you could understand, let's say we have the following procedure. It's a higher order procedure, so it takes as an argument some other procedure which doesn't have any input parameters. And also it doesn't give you back anything. And then whenever you supply the spawn procedure a reference to such other procedure, what the spawn procedure will do is, well, you call this procedure and then spawning it creates a new process which will the new process that is created will be executing the supplied procedure, that the procedure that you have supplied as an argument to the spawn, while the spawn procedure itself immediately returns. So to give you a bit of a concrete idea how this looks like, and again, I use the black dots to indicate where the control point of a process is. Let's suppose we have the following program. We initialize the variable x1, we initialize the variable y to be 1, and then we perform a call to the fork procedure. So what this does, it is called to the fork procedure. It in the original process, so the process that performed the call, we will return false. But also we will copy the process that performs this call. And in the copy of the process, this is a new process, the return value will be true. So what we then get is after the fork returns, it returns in two different processes, namely in the original process. So let's say that this column here is representing the control point of the original process. It will return false, so it continues with the else branch. But in the new process, let's say that's in this column here, it will continue within the then branch of the if statement. So it's in this code block that it will continue. So that demonstrates to you how you could construct new processes programmatically. As an example of spawning, let's consider this program. So let's say we initialize x and y with the value 1, and then we spawn. What does spawn do? In the original process, so the process that performed the call, we immediately return. But in a new process, we will execute the procedure that was supplied. And in this case, the procedure supplied is a continuation, so we will execute it in a new process. So again, here we see two control points representing two processes. And you might want to think of yourself, also in the previous example, how will the rest of the program then continue? What will the program do? Okay, so that is forking and spawning. Let me now say to you quite an interesting concept in concurrency, namely, now that we have a program text and we have multiple processes that are executing in our program text, can we make sure that there are some pieces of the program text in which it is ensured that at most one process is executing within that text section? And this is called the critical section of a program, or a critical section, because a program could have multiple critical sections. Let's say a critical section of a program, a particular critical section of a program, it is never the case that it is executed by more than one process at the same time. So it means that whenever you have a piece of text, it is never the case that in that piece of text that there are multiple control points belonging to different processes are within that piece of text executing. So to accomplish critical sections, you can make use of a programming construct that is called a lock. And a lock you can think of as protecting a piece of program text such that you can enter only the program text whenever it is guaranteed that no other process is within that critical section. And moreover, whenever there is still a process in that critical section, it is guaranteed that no other process will enter at the same time that piece of that section of the program. So whenever you want to exit the critical section, you have to explicitly unlock. And now with these two programming constructs, lock and unlock, you could then implement critical sections in your program. I'll show an example later. So a way of implementing such locks is by making use of semaphores. And it's actually quite nice if you think of the analogy of railways. So suppose that you have two tracks on which two locomotives are positioned. And now the two tracks are merged into a single track. And then later on, the single track then diverges again into two tracks. So now whenever we have the two locomotives and we would allow them both at the same time to continue, they would crash together, right? And this is what you want to prevent. So in the railway system, you can make use of semaphores. So that means a semaphore is basically a signal that then signals to the operator of the locomotive not to proceed at that point. So then you can ensure that to protect this single track, whenever a locomotive wants to enter the track, that it then signals and the semaphore is raised for at most one of the locomotives, or at least for one of the tracks where a locomotive is positioned. And while a semaphore is raised and the locomotive is traveling over this single piece of track, no other locomotive can enter because there the semaphore is still lowered. And now this analogy may allow you to understand, okay, well, this this is it's too much detail to explain precisely how it works, but I mean, in a future course on concurrency, this becomes more clear. But at least it gives you an idea of what are the techniques behind implementing these concepts. Okay. So let's consider an example. So here we have two pieces of the program. Let's suppose we did some forking before, but that does not matter. Let's say that we have the process on the left and we have a process on the right. So now suppose the process on the left executes x is 5 and the process on the right executes y is 3. So then we now, in a shared memory setting, have updated x and y, that's now 5 and 3. So now it is the case, let's think of again these locomotives, that they are entering this point, the lock command. And the lock command ensures that whatever piece of the program that follows is a critical section. So these two pieces of the program are critical sections. So that means that whenever there is a process that wants to execute this command, that there is not at the same time a process that is executing these other commands. So this is also called mutually exclusive. The execution of the commands on the left is mutually exclusive with the execution of the commands on the right at the same time. Now, in the case of the lock, let's think again of these semaphores, that there are now two locomotives waiting on two separate tracks. And they are both waiting until a semaphore is raised. So let's say some external operator of the semaphore raises the semaphore of the process on the right. So the process on the right can take then a step and it can enter this single track. And the other locomotive on the left, it has to wait. So now this locomotive reaches the end and then it performs the unlock operation, so the unlock command. And by that, it releases the critical section. By that, it signals that the critical section no longer contains process. So that means that afterwards, it is now possible for the process on the left to enter the critical section. And indeed, it can enter the critical section, perform the commands, print the result, and then itself also unlock and therefore exit the critical section. The output of the program, try to trace it back yourself, can be determined to be 6. Now you could ask yourself the question, are there other outputs possible? And now the trick is to realize that the commands before the lock are in no way related to each other. So it is possible for a process on the left to entirely execute without a process on the right to be executing at all. So that means, since we haven't specified what the value of y was initially for the process on the left, its value can be arbitrary. So consider that you have a process that executes only the commands on the left, but that the process on the right is very slow. For instance, it's not scheduled, or maybe the physical processor that it runs on is just a bit slower. So all these commands that are then executed are all executed, and then this value of y can be arbitrary. So that also means that the value of x after this addition can be arbitrary. So how can we make sure that whenever we have multiple processes, that we know that the other processes have reached a point in the program? Well, for that, there are this concept of barriers. You can think barriers as horse races. You put a number of horses on the tracks, and then there is a barrier that maintains the position of the horses. And for the horse race to be sort of fair, so that you can know which horse is the first to reach the finish, it is important that when the race starts, the barrier is released for all the horses at the same time. But now imagine that we do not have a single race, but we have multiple races happening after each other. So that means that the horses are stuck behind the barrier, then the barrier is released, and then all the horses run up to the next barrier. And then at the next barrier, the barrier will only be released when all the horses are set up right before the barrier, and then the barrier is released again. For instance, on a circular track, you could imagine this. Okay, so the barrier is a way to make sure that processes know of other processes to have reached a certain point, a certain control point. To give you more of a concrete example, Oh yeah, this is what I explained. Hè? A barrier causes a process to wait until all other processes also reach the barrier. And now you can alternatively give this the name that a barrier is a synchronizer among all the processes. Yeah, so this the all the processes that reach the barrier then are synchronized after then the barrier is released. You could argue, okay, well, there are global barriers that talk about all the processes in a concurrent system. Or you could say, well, you could also have local barriers, which only talk about a subset of the processes. Yeah? So that it is not necessarily the case that all processes have to arrive at a particular barrier, but in local barrier, also some processes could arrive. Yeah? You could, for instance, have in a concurrent system consisting of 1,000 processes, still have a barrier between 2 of the processes. That's also possible. It's a local barrier. Anyway, let's consider an example. So here you have an example of a barrier. Yeah? So let's say the process on the left executes x is 5, and the process on the right executes x is 3. Right? Let's say in this order. It is now the case that we have what I now say is the sync command. It is now the case that the processes have to wait until all the other processes arrived. Eh? So in the case that the X executed 5 on the left, it cannot proceed because the process on the right is not yet there. So the process on the left is waiting before the process on the right has also encountered the sync command. And now we release the barrier, so both processes can continue. Let's say that the process on the left executes first a command, and then the process on the right executes. But now the process on the left cannot continue. Eh? It is stuck against the next barrier. It can only continue when all the processes, in this case there are only 2 processes, when all the processes have reached the barrier. So the process on the right is the only one that can execute. So we basically slow down on purpose the process on the left. Okay, so the process on the right then executes its commands, and now both have reached the sync command, and then both proceed as if the barrier is released, and then the process on the left prints the output. And you can again trace back yourself why the output is 6 by executing the commands on some shared memory state. Okay, this is what I wanted to say. I hope you found this video useful, and I hope to see you soon again. Thank you for watching, and see you later.